The Topeka City Council meeting will come to order. If you would please rise and give your attention to Councilwoman Dela Isla for the invocation. Remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Dear God, thank you so much for this evening. Lord, tonight I pray specifically for all of the city employees. Father God, our people that are being our public service people, our people that work with our infrastructure, and all of the staff that help us have our day-to-day. Lord, as we're getting ready for this meeting, give us wisdom, God, as we're making decisions for our city and for the betterment of our community. Continue blessing us, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Tonight, we are recognizing the importance of the Constitution of the United States, and with me are members of the local chapter of the Daughters of the American Revolution, Regent Carol Roberts, Nancy Appelhans, and Laura Bond. The Daughters of the American Revolution have as one of their major tasks recognizing, celebrating, and getting people to be a part of and remember the U.S. Constitution. So we have a proclamation along that line. Whereas September 17, 2015 marks the 228th anniversary of the drafting of the Constitution of the United States of America by the Constitutional Convention, and whereas it is fitting and proper to accord official recognition to this magnificent document and its memorable anniversary and to the patriotic celebrations that will commemorate the occasion, and whereas Public Law 915 guarantees the issuing each year of a proclamation by the President of the United States of America designating the week of September 17 through 23 as Constitution Week, now therefore I, Larry Wolgast, Mayor of the City, do hereby proclaim the week of September 17 to 23 as Constitution Week and urge Topekans to reflect on the privilege of being an American with all the rights and responsibilities that that privilege involves. If you would have some comments.
I want to thank you very much for this opportunity to accept this proclamation. The Daughters of the American Revolution are a community service organization, and we concentrate on education, patriotism, and historic preservation. And so for those reasons, I thank you very much.
Thank you, Carol. There are no presentations this evening, so we will proceed with the roll call.
Mayor Wolgast?
Here.
Ms. Hiller?
Here.
Ms. Clear?
Here.
Ms. Ortiz?
Here.
Mr. Shum?
Here.
Mr. Dela Isla?
Here.
Mr. Here. Jensen?
Present.
Ms. Schwartz?
Here.
Mr. Cohen?
Here.
And Mr. Harmon?
Here.
Council members, we have an addition to the agenda this evening, a call on Councilwoman Hiller.
You should have in front of you a one-page item, which is a resolution regarding an alcoholic liquor allowance for a group that is doing the Alley Fest on October the 10th. This is a new group to do such an event, and because we don't have meetings for the next 2 weeks, they really needed it added this evening so that they can finish all the arrangements. So with that, I would request that this item be added as item, let's see,
J,
I suppose, on the consent agenda, item four.
J on the consent agenda. Deputy Mayor Hiller has moved to add that item. Is there a second? Councilwoman Dela Isla seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor vote yes. Opposed vote no. I vote yes.
We have 10 yes.
10 having voted yes, the item is added to the agenda. That is the only addition. There are no deletions, and there is no executive session this evening. So we will proceed with the consent agenda. Clerk would read.
It is a resolution introduced by Councilmember Jeffrey Cohen granting Megan Watkins an exception to the provisions of City of Topeka Code Section 945-150 at C concerning noise prohibitions. B is a resolution introduced by Councilmember Elaine Schwartz granting Christ the King Catholic Church an exception to the provisions of City of Topeka Code Section 945-150 at C concerning noise prohibitions. C is a resolution introduced by Deputy Mayor Karen Hiller granting Downtown Topeka Incorporated an exception to the provisions of City of Topeka Code Section 945-150 at C concerning noise prohibitions. D is a resolution introduced by Deputy Mayor Karen Hiller granting Let's Help an exception to the provisions of City of Topeka Code Section 945-150 at C concerning noise prohibitions. E is a resolution introduced by Deputy Mayor Karen Hiller approving a special event known as the Capital City Jazz and Food Truck Festival. F is a resolution introduced by Deputy Mayor Karen Hiller approving a special event known as the 2015 Downtown Adventure Race Topeka. G is a resolution introduced by Councilmember Sylvia Ortiz granting Randy Wheat an exception to the provisions of City of Topeka Code Section 945-150 at C concerning noise prohibitions. H is minutes of the regular meeting of September 8, 2015. There are no applications before you this evening. And J is a resolution introduced by Councilmember Karen Hiller approving a special event known as the 2015 Topeka Alley Fest.
Okay, five noise resolutions, I think, is a record. Some place is going to be a noisy place around here for the next 2 weeks. That is the consent agenda. What is your pleasure? Councilman Jensen?
Move approval.
Councilman moves approval. Councilwoman Elisla seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor vote yes. Opposed vote no. I vote yes.
We have 10 yes.
10 having voted yes, the consent agenda is approved as read. Proceed to the action items. The first item is a labor agreement.
A is approval of a 3-year labor agreement between the City of Topeka and the Fraternal Order of Police Lodge Number 3.
Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to ask Jackie Russell and Catherine Walter to step forward and present information on this item and provide an opportunity to answer any questions that this body may have.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council. We're here, or before you on the agenda tonight, is a 3-year labor agreement between the city and the FOP bargaining unit. The union has ratified the agreement. There is a financial memo in your packet, as well as a summary of the items which are included within the tentative agreement. And with that, the staff would request that the labor agreement be approved.
All right, we have heard a presentation previously on this. Council members, do you have questions, comments, or questions, I guess, first for Ms. Walters, Ms. Russell? Councilman Harmon.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't know to which one of you should, this question be directed. It actually pertains to the memorandum prepared by Brandon. Should I ask you or should I ask Brandon? Or?
Why don't you just ask or the city manager direct it to the appropriate person.
All right. Tell you what my question is. In the second paragraph, it says that there will be an increase to the pay matrices with an average wage increase of 4.37% in 2016, 2% in 2017, and 1.41% in 2018. Then if you go down to lower on the page to the box, it shows the increase from prior year for 2016 is 2.79%, 2017 2.55%, and 2018 4.08%. Those percentages don't correlate by year, so what am I not understanding?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilman Harmon, I'm going to ask Nikki Lee, the budget manager, to step forward and answer those questions specifically.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council.
What you're referring to is on the memo. The top section refers to the average pay matrix increase for the average employee. And you've also got in the agenda item a copy of the FOP pay matrix. And the percentage between steps for our police officers varies. So it's between 1 and 18. If you're between 1 and 2, 4 and 5, 17 and 18, it really varies based on where you are in the matrix. So that percentage just provides the average. And then at the bottom there, it gives a overall percentage to the budget over the prior budget year. So there's a lot of different reasons why that would vary and not really correlate. The main one would be from 15 to 16. The 15 budget was set at a time that the police department looked different than it does now. So for example, we have more entry-level police officers now than we did at the time we set the 15 budget. So even though it looks like the percentage increase is lower from 15 to 16, it's actually because we did some modifications mid-year to the 15 budget. The reason that from 17 to 18 it actually looks higher than you would think is that the 17 increases are actually set to go into effect 1% in the beginning of the year and then 1% in July. So that makes the impact from 17 to 18 lower because that percentage increase for each employee is happening at a different time of the year. So that's it's hard to explain really concisely, but that's kind of the overview.
Well, Your Honor, if I can follow up here on that makes sense, Nikki. So the increases in described in the second paragraph pertain to the pay matrixes.
Yes.
Whereas the percentage increases in the box at the lower of the page pertains to the overall budget impact.
Exactly. In the box, that refers to the budget by position. So it takes, you know, in the top is just the average to each employee.
Right.
And then in the box there, it actually applies it to actually every single employee based on where they are in the matrix and then based on when that matrix goes into effect and when their step date is.
Okay.
So the box is actually based on exact dates and exact steps and exact pay rates.
Okay.
And then those percentages on top are just an average of the percentage of the increases between steps.
Okay. Thank you very much, Nikki.
Yeah.
Thank you, Your
Thank
Honor.
You.
Thank you. Thank you, Nikki. Councilwoman Schwartz.
Thank you, Your Honor. Nikki, don't go too far because
okay,
I have
I'm sorry.
Another question. On that same memo from Brandon, it says under the box that it's a 1.949 levy increase equivalent. So when is that levy increase supposed to be occurring?
So what that is on the top of the memo, what it states is that pursuant to Kansas statutes, we're supposed to relay to the council anytime we have a contract. If there were no other changes to the budget and we had to pay for this out of straight up a mill levy increase, how much would it be? So what that is that's a simple calculation of the three-year increase. If we made no other changes to our total general fund operating budget, we took it exactly like it was today, did all these changes, nothing else changed, that's what it would translate to. But in actuality, as we get to each budget year, we look at the budget, we assess with you all what the priorities are. You all set in the beginning usually your goal of where you want the mill levy to land. So if, for example, your guidance is that mill levy is to remain flat for that next budget, then we would find a way to absorb this increase.
Okay. If I may follow up, I think when I ran for office, I said I will not vote to increase taxes in my 4 years that I was elected to. So I can't really justify voting for this, and especially at the presentation last week, we heard that the salaries will be more in line with Overland Park and Olathe, but we did not take into consideration the cost of living based in Kansas City, Olathe, and Overland Park, based in Topeka. So that study really did show that we're going to be really over if we included the cost of living. I think Chief Brown is on the right track, and I really appreciate all this, but I still will hang my hat on the resource allocation study that compared us to 17 other cities. I think we're on the right track, but I am not going to vote for anything that says there's equivalent of a 1.949 levy increase, you know, that's going to happen. So, thank you.
And to clarify, this really doesn't involve a mill levy increase, but if we had none, you know, this is the equivalent of it. So it is something in our terminology here that we're sort of a difference of juncture. Are there other questions on the agreement to the presenters? Okay, seeing none, thank you. And then the council members, you have general discussion comment. Councilman Shum.
I'd like to make a motion to approve.
All right, Council Shum has moved to approve the labor agreement. Councilman DeLisle seconds. Is there a discussion? Okay, Councilman Shum. Okay, he yields. Councilman Ortiz.
I just want to know if a union representative is here. Is the union?
I think, mm-hmm. Yes, there are.
The president.
Would you, is there someone, I think, president of the FOP? Many times we provide the opportunity for the union to comment, and if you wish to do so, and Councilwoman Ortiz.
How are you doing? I know we've come a long way, and appreciate the agreement, and I didn't know if you had any words. Are you guys satisfied?
Mayor, council, men and women, we appreciate the opportunity to come before you today. We are extremely satisfied with what we've worked hard to obtain in the last 6 to 8 months, coming to this decision together.
All right.
Thank you, Chief Brown.
Chief Brown, would you care to make some comments?
Yeah, this is a good contract, and I stand behind this contract 100%. I stand behind my officers, and this is the way to go, and I'm asking for the support of the entire council for this.
Thank you. Thank you. Councilman Shum.
Thank you. I've been clear since I've been on the council that our officers deserve comparable pay, and to be honest, this gets them pretty close. It's not a perfect world. They gave up some things. I know that some detectives will be dressing a lot more nicely, and the management with the chief obtained some things that the chief felt were very important. To be honest with you, this is probably the best possible outcome, better than I could have dreamed when I first heard that the FOP was at coming to an impasse with the city. This agreement to see the, to hear the a pleasure from the chief and management, to hear the pleasure from the FOP was not imaginable 6 months ago. So I want to commend you all for working together, for finding a way to support our officers in a way that makes me proud to be a Topekan, and to the men and women in blue, well deserved. Thank you for your patience with the city. Thank you for your willingness to negotiate. And I applaud you and salute this way that you've managed to resolve and bring to us something that's great for the entire city.
Thank you. Councilman Jensen.
I just want to quickly thank both sides for sticking it out and continuing to work together. I know it's sometimes it's difficult to continue to come back to the table when you are in an impasse, and that just shows the caliber of the folks we have on both sides working as a team to get to this, and that's very commendable. Thank you for your efforts and your service. Much appreciated.
Other comments? Okay, we have a motion for approval of the labor agreement. All those in favor vote yes, opposed vote no. I vote yes.
We have 9 yes, Ms. Schwartz voting no.
9 having voted yes, labor agreement is approved. Could have the FOP members stand, please. I know there are a number in the audience. Just so that we, as I think the comments have been very nicely stated by council members and both sides, and Catherine Walters and Jackie Russell and others, Nikki, thank you for your effort for bringing this together. Then you are free to leave if you wish. Next, that completes the action items for this evening. We go to the non-action items. The clerk would read the first item.
A is discussion regarding the use of the countywide retailer's half-cent sales tax.
Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As we get rolling, I'm going to ask Brandon Kaufman to step forward and give a little bit of a history of the interlocal agreement and the countywide Hess and sales tax. And as he's coming into position, I really just want to touch on a couple of points. From a housekeeping perspective, you have received in your electronically, but also in your packet, three separate documents or three pieces. One is a four-page letter which outlines the recommendations to provide as a discussion outline. Secondly, there's an Excel spreadsheet which we'll talk about, but it compares some original discussion that the city had in the first column. In the second column is the recommendations that had been forwarded to the city by the county commission back at the end of last year, beginning of this year. And in the third column is the recommendations that are being brought forward to you by city staff. And then the last one is a map that we'll make reference to pertaining to an idea that we have generally talked about in a lot of different settings, but never really as a body or even in great depth. The hope today is to drive an engaged conversation and ultimately result in an informed decision on something that's very important. We're talking about a lot of money. $262 million is projected over the next 15 years, and making sure that that living up to our commitment to be judicious in our fiduciary responsibilities to the to this particular community. I want to say, from a procedural perspective, I envision at least three meetings, this being the first, that this conversation would occur between this body. Secondly, assuming that there is a consensus of going forward, that we would have another discussion only item with the specific resolution and specific language included in that resolution, and assuming that the body is ready to proceed, to come back at a third meeting with an action item. So I don't want anybody to get the impression, especially with the idea about some ideas that were thrown out here, that we want to slam this thing through very quickly. I think if we've learned anything, it's absolutely vital that we discuss, you discuss, we provide opportunities for the residents of this community to learn and to share their opinions with you. So the goal here is to really lead a conversation. And while I often refer to city staff, it's really not just city staff. It's city staff engaged in a lot of conversations over a long period of time with this body, within the community, listening to the county and everybody else. Remember, we've been talking about this for over a year. It's been sitting for close to 6 months, and this is that first step to get it rolling again. So without any further comment, I would ask Mr. Kaufman to step forward and provide a very brief overview on the history of the countywide Hess and sales tax of the interlocal agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Kaufman.
Mayor, members of the council, so the Hefson countywide started almost 12 years ago. Started January 1st, 2005, with the end date of December 31st, 2016. The way that it's a countywide Hefson sales tax, so it's collected by the state, and then the state distributes that based on a statutory formula that's split by population and by taxes levied. So that is split to the cities in the county and then also to the county. So some of the cities like Rossville, they get a portion also of the countywide half-cent sales tax. Generally, there's a two-month lag with collections with any type of sales tax through the state. So that is distributed by the state to the entities with the cities and the county within Shawnee County. That money is then taken from Topeka and Shawnee County. That was agreed on by interlocal agreement back in 2004, and then given to the JADO board, which is a separate financial entity from both the city and the county. That money is then held by JADO and then distributed for the various things that the ballot language approved, economic development, county bridges, projects, debt service for the JADO bridge. So looking back, you know, it's a little bit hard to find some of the documents. I'm trying to find a little bit more of what they estimated. And back at the time, to me, it looks like they estimated a revenue growth of about 0.8%. So I think we're coming in a little bit ahead of that. And then also on the project expenditure side, you know, we're completely done. Well, we have one more project that is yet to be complete. I can pass around this sheet and take a look at that. That was provided at the JADO meeting last week. So the one project that's still not complete is Southwest 21st. Urish Road to Indian Hills, that's in the process. They're looking at purchasing right-of-way right now. And then we have debt service payments until 2016 on JADO Bridge. So it looks like I can't find any project expenditures for original estimates of these projects. However, I do know, for example, when we refinanced the JADO Bridge debt service, we saved about $4 million there in bond payments alone by lowering the interest rate from around 4% to 1% annually. So ending balances as we approach to year end, we have this one project left, debt service, the JADO money for the $5 million, and then the $1.5 million for county bridges. We're estimating that that balance could be approximately $18 million, depending on how the sales tax comes in. Once that ending balance, once all the final project costs are paid out for the Southwest 21st next year, then once we have everything final, if JADO didn't come to agreement as to how those funds would be split, then it would be split based on the statutory formula, which is half population and then half taxes levied, which might generate about 54% going to the city at that time. So a little over $9 million could possibly come to the city at the basically beginning of 2017, and at that time would be free and unencumbered if the JADO governing body didn't make any other decisions.
Okay. Good. That's the background. Yes. Councilman Ortiz.
You keep referring to the JADO Bridge. I don't understand.
Oh. Councilman Ortiz, but JADO, I mean the Topeka Boulevard.
There we go. We got a new JADO
transition.
All right.
The bridge in town.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Other questions, background up to this point? All right. Continue. Yeah.
That's it. He said brief.
Okay, all right. Then we go to the next stage two.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'll pick up here.
You're on.
Great. I do want to make reference. There's a lot of information here. This is a topic that is of extreme interest to a lot of people, the county, a lot of our residents, certainly this body. We've placed these specific documents online so people can look at it. We'll update it based on what happens this evening and going forward based on the direction of this body. And just to touch on, so in 2014, November, the county sent to us a resolution which suggested the language for the interlocal agreement. Staff has had an opportunity to clarify that with members of the county commission and others, and we have really offered four specific comments about that. And I don't want to get hung up on these comments and let us come back into our specific recommendation, but we're here to serve you, and as you have a question, we certainly want to answer that. Under the county proposal, we did not believe that as structured, the city would be able to complete a substantial road projects any earlier than 8 years into the funding mechanism, and that certainly caused us some concerns since we all heard that streets was the number one priority of people as we address this. The reason for that was the structure of the priorities, putting the Expo Center improvements and paying for it on a cash basis. The city staff is concerned about the funding of the Expo Center at $45 million. There was a lot of discussion. I want to commend H.R. Cook and SMG, both of that organization and H.R. on their behalf, has done a phenomenal job in terms of communicating, and this isn't a stab at him or SMG, it's just a recommendation based on
our understanding of what is best, or at least what our opinion is of what's best for the future of this community. This body needs to determine that, but we would support a funding level of $25 million and really focus on the equestrian development and just and basic repairs going forward. The county proposal also has the bridges being allocated annually in the same manner as the JADO economic development funding. And our recommendation would be that you actually treat the bridge money similar to how you would treat all of the rest of the quality of life and infrastructure projects, and that it would be dispersed as part of that larger amount. The prioritization schedule as presented by the county really didn't line up with the city's street prioritization problem. Now, that's not a huge issue. I know that we could sit down with them and agree to it, but I just wanted to outline that it wasn't the same as ours. So that being all of that being said, there was a remarkable amount of agreement between what the county was recommending and what this body had talked about and what staff thinks is the right way to would recommend to go forward. The recommendations on the city include six. The first is that we would recommend that the economic development allocation that is currently provided by JADO to the contractor would remain at $5 million a year, and that they are paid out of the first funds received, so that consistent with the current agreement. Secondly, we agree with the county that $32.5 million over the life of the project would be made available for bridges. We believe that this is a major issue for the county, but for the community as a whole. The city staff agrees with the list of street projects and the funding amounts. There's no discrepancy between the county and the city in terms of the projects and the funding amount for each of those projects. It was really just a matter of the list and the prioritization. We also agree with the county's list of quality of life projects and the specific funding amounts, with the only exception of the Expo Center, where we would reduce that from, we would recommend reducing that from $45 billion to $25. I think this is one of the structural differences between what we're recommending and what the county was talking about, is we believe that all funds, with the exception of the economic development funds, would be allocated annually on a prorated basis. So in this particular case, if you take the total amount of money and it would be $80 million for the county and $86 million for the city, and you determine what's the prorated share of that based on the total number, in this case it would become 51% and 49%, or 52% and 48%. Each year when the funds were dispersed, you first take the economic development funds, and then 52% goes to city and 48%. By the way, I'm making those percentage numbers up here, so I don't want anybody to check my math. So instead of having to worry about prioritization, each organization would be responsible for their own priority, and they could make a determination as to whether they wanted to fund something on a cash as you go basis, or, as was referenced earlier, taking advantage of the bond market, recognizing that they have a certain amount of cash, and then they could bond something going forward, depending on what was best in their own opinion. Number six is something that's brand new. I have, for the last 3 years, I've talked about four specific priorities for the city. One of those was addressing the budget and the financial condition. Number two was talking about public safety. Number three was talking about code enforcement and improving property values through removal of blight and improving neighborhoods. And the fourth was economic development platform. This is not meant to be a lightning rod. This is meant to be the opening of a conversation. But as I've talked to many people, especially in the neighborhoods, there was some concern about urban economic development and whether the economic development platform that was being practiced today was really having an impact really in East and North Topeka. And the idea here was that you could have a economic development program funded for about $15 million a year or $1 million a year, and that would focus on workforce development for people who are currently either underemployed or unemployed or underemployed. This certainly could include veterans, and people who just haven't been successful competing in the marketplace as it exists. And in many regards, these are people who their next option isn't just to maybe wander into Washburn Tech and take some classes, is people who have to be worked even towards that. And there's a lot of conversation that would need to happen here. So that's the first part. The second part would be really formalizing some sort of youth employment program and even some apprentice programs that would allow us to take under the wings those young people in the community, some in a very informal summer basis, some in a very serious basis of taking them and helping them achieve their goals. The third portion of this would be using some funds for the rehabilitation of blighted and derelict, underutilized facilities that exist in parts of town that aren't receiving capital investment, and use those for the purpose of improving the facilities and the infrastructure so that those facilities could be brought into the economic mainstream and that they could be used to host new companies or even compete on a retail basis going forward. And the last aspect of this would be to identify some specific job training funds and workforce recruitment funds that could really provide a neighborhood-oriented economic growth. This doesn't have to be the huge companies, it could be 10 companies, but companies that would make a difference in the lives of the people in a part of the town that historically hasn't been the recipient of economic development funds, and also allow us to bring people who have historically not been part of our economy, or at least traditional economy, give them an opportunity to do something different. And it is not going to be easy, and it's not going to be hard, and it's certainly not going to be done by the city or by the city as a whole, but I think it's a matter of a partnership going forward. We've had a lot of conversations about where that would go, and I don't know that I really want to get into that. Is it geographic? Is it based on specific needs? We sort of tied it into the city's neighborhood revitalization areas, but we excluded downtown. We didn't want it to become another downtown funding thing, but we also think it has to include parts that aren't included in the maps of Oakland, and that would need to be included, but we can talk more about that as before. So that is the basis of the city's recommendations. Just to do the math here, we're talking about over the next 15 years the generation of about $262 million in funds based on 1% annual growth, which may be the right number. I mean, we were way at 3 at the beginning of this year. We're probably running a little bit below 1% now. But if you look back in the averages, 1% seems to be a good number going forward. But we would always walk there. I want to be very clear. I did make an error under the projected funds available under economic development. I talked about JADO, and then I referred to specifically Go Topeka, as was pointed out by Deputy Mayor Hiller. I think more appropriate it would be the economic development contractor selected by the city, and not make an assumption. So I apologize for having said that way. But under this particular program, as described and prior to conversation and input by you, JADO contractor would be $75 million of the 262. The Urban Economic Development Program would represent $15 million. Under infrastructure, the county would have $32.5 million for bridges and $23.1 million for streets. The city would have $67.1 million for streets. The county would, under quality of life, would have $25 million. That's for the Expo Center. The city would have $18.5 million, and that is for the zoo and others. And I want to make reference, on this spreadsheet are the specific individual activities and the funding amounts. And so from a total investment perspective, economic development would be $90 million with both the contractor and the Urban Economic Development Program. The county would receive a total of $80.6 million. The city would receive a total of $85.6 million. And that would leave a projected remainder of $6.25 million. And we just thought it was best to have some wiggle room just in case projections didn't come in where they did, so people could plan more accordingly. And my only comment to wrap this up is really tie up to Mr. Kaufman's comments that we're coming to the end in December 31st of 2016. The current program, we project, in my earlier numbers, $8.2 million that would fund to the city, and $6.9 million, which would fund to the county. I know that there were some questions at the JADO meeting as to how that's accessed. To simply state it, if there's an, once the projects are finished, if there's an agreement between the county and the city, they could be used as determined between the two. If there's no agreement upon the conclusion of the projects in the time frame, those funds could be used by either organization based on prorated share, based on their own wishes. So I know that was a lot of information. My hope is just to start a conversation, and am happy to make myself or other staff available to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you for the overview. One thought I had in here, and you referenced the in the county's interlocal agreement where they had more of a statement, a plan of how the money would be allocated as it came in. And that's what you're referencing, that we would see things differently. And I think we received a copy of the county's their interlocal agreement that they sent to us months ago, but maybe at some point you can provide another copy.
Mr. Mayor, two things. Yes, your recollection is exactly right. There was a negotiated prioritization list in the previous interlocal agreement. In the document that was sent over in November, they had a list, and that's what I made reference to at the beginning of my comments. I will first thing in the morning forward back to this body a copy of the documents that we received from the county. Yeah.
And I agree with your proposal of the allocation process. I think that's much more appropriate than the other one. Councilman Shum.
I appreciate this proposal. I know the biggest thing on everyone's mind is streets. Under this proposal, what I'm seeing is that we put $67 million from the city on streets. The county would put about $23 million, about $90 million total, another $32 million for bridges. So I think it's about time that we're spending more on streets than we're spending on JADO. I'm glad to see $90 million versus $75 million. I think that's a step in the right direction, and that we've got to get our streets done, and we've got to be serious about it. I am, for full disclosure, on the Expo Center board, so when this comes for a vote, I will abstain. However, I could not justify spending money on the Expo Center rather than spending it on streets to get to the Expo Center. So I strongly urge that we do get this done, we do get the streets done, and I am really encouraged by the city taking on an economic development for some areas of the city that quite honestly feel ignored, and they tell me that every day that I talk to them. So JADO and GoTopeka have found what they think they're good at, and they've got a track record. There are some gaps that are perceived by the rest of Topeka, and I'm glad that we're addressing them. I would support developing this further and seeing what we can do to bring economic development to the rest of Topeka.
Thank you. Councilman Jensen. Councilwoman De Elisa.
Thank you, Mayor Wolgast. This is splendid. I think it was 2 weeks ago, I had a two-hour meeting in the Highcrest area, and we were just debating how can we go ahead and work not only on ensuring that the housing stock that is there is up to date, but more importantly, how do we ensure that the individuals that are living in these neighborhoods are able to have a way to better themselves? And how are we going to work on developing strategies to bring training to the places where they're needed? Because one of the things that we know, and we were having this discussion recently, is that it's so difficult when you're economically disenfranchised to be able to travel somewhere in order for you to get the education and the training that you need. And we have to start thinking outside of the box. We have to start getting creative. And in that meeting, we were just talking about, wouldn't it be wonderful for us to have some sort of strategy that will be targeted directly at these neighborhoods, not just Highcrest, but all the neighborhoods that have the red, focus on the red. The neighborhoods that are in high distress, and see what the needs are and try to understand what those needs are, because guess what? If we are able to raise that stock, our city becomes a better place. And to see that the same discussions that we're having at the community level are starting to be reflected in the budgeting process of the economic development funds, it's just exciting. So I am very supportive of the Urban Economic Development Program. Of course, we don't have full details on how this would pan out or how it would look, but I think that at least the basic explanation of what is saying that it would hope to do is something that our community has been begging for a long time. This is wonderful.
Thank you. Councilman Jackson.
Excellent work. I'm extremely excited about this proposal. One question I might ask, if it's possible to carve a portion of the street budget out and specifically allocate it to alleys. Folks have been screaming about alleys for a long, long time, and my expectation is that they're included in, within the streets. However, if we made that a very specific line item and tried to address those issues, I think a lot of folks in the public would feel much more comfortable about it, if that's possible. Again, I don't know, but you know, from a 30,000 foot view, this plan is fantastic, and I cannot wait to implement it. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, City Manager, you want to respond on that issue?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Councilmember Johnson. So, and I was going to say this at the beginning of the comments, it's very important to understand that we are limited to spending this money on the specific ballot language that was approved by the voters. So when we're talking about, we couldn't just say, I want to do this particular street because we want to add it to the street projects. We can, though, as it is impactful of economic development, we can address that. And so it, within the urban program, we're talking about the rehabilitation of infrastructure and facilities that specifically supports economic development, which certainly would be allowable under that. We have talked a lot about alleys, and I don't want to go off into that, but we do have alleys specifically in our focus, and especially in the HEFS and Sales Tracks program that we're also talking about. So that message is understood and going forward.
Thank you.
And that's the other HEFS and Sales Tax.
That is the citywide HEFS and Sales Tax.
Well, yeah, but it does get confusing to people because we have two HEFS and Sales Tax. Deputy Mayor Hilbert?
I too am excited about this fresh look at the overall approach to the county. I did not see it till about an hour and a half ago, so I will maybe have some further questions. A couple of comments right off the top. If when City Manager, when you send the county proposal, when we look at the chart, there first was a city proposal and then a county proposal. So if we're going to send background, if we could send people both of them, it might be full disclosure helpful.
Mr. Mayor and Deputy Mayor, just to address that, if you remember back over a year ago when we had this discussion and passed a resolution in support of it, this body made a determination not to include specific numbers, but to include the specific items included. So that first column, you have to take it as really just some ideas that we had and we talked about it. Never, in fact, a smarter guy would have just taken it out and not have included it, you know, in the discussion. But because I wanted to provide full information, it was reflective of some conversation that we had at the beginning, but it really doesn't exist other than because we made an official decision not to have specific amounts, but to come back and address specific amounts after the ballot was approved.
Yeah, and that's very, very important, so that we aren't tied down to those specific numbers.
We ended up getting a whole book that had a lot of original information and descriptions of each of the projects back in July of 2014, and so maybe if that's still around, and some of us have it, and others could just get it matched. If I could ask a couple of questions. I too am, what you described for this urban economic development approach is very fresh, and it really does respond to the kinds of things that we've discussed. And as Councilwoman De La Isla said, it's not developed yet, but it's kind of exciting to consider looking at that. If I could ask the city manager what his vision was about how this proposal for the $15 million would relate to the set aside currently that we have for a minimum of 10%, that always it kind of blurred to me in terms of minority priorities as well as entrepreneurship. But and now we also have a makerspace that really wasn't envisioned in that first one too. Could you talk for a moment about how you envision these?
Well, just so I understand your question, you're really talking about the economic development money for that JADO has?
Well, when we had the $5 million a year right now, as had it before, has a 10% set aside for minority and economic development. minorities and women in economic entrepreneurship.
That's right.
And so I didn't know if there was some thought
Thank you. I
understand. About that carrying forward or how it would relate to this new proposal.
So, Mr. Mayor and Ms. Deputy Mayor, that's a very difficult question for me to answer other than to say it's different. It is specifically designed for the needs that have been identified. I think it's very important that, as far as this discussion is concerned, you know, that we understand what the contractor is responsible for. I think we all have to understand what our level of what's occurred in the past and whether you believe that can make a difference. I want to be this body or the JADO, but this body as part of the JADO body has done a good job in terms of driving the conversation in terms of accountability and new programs going forward. But at this particular moment, I can't really comment on any of that. I don't know what it is. I think Glenda Washington and has been doing a very good job. But in this particular case, I see it as a very specific program designed for the needs of Topeka.
Thank you. When people see the current interlocal agreement and when they see the county draft, they will see the language carrying forward that has that the language from before and has the 10% set aside. So as we move forward and fine-tune language, we will need to address what we want to do about it.
And, you know, I know the point, the $500,000 that JADO spends in this area, I believe, is primarily spent on workforce development. A great deal of it is on workforce development and related areas. Whereas is it correct to say what proposing here, the urban development, is really looking, and we have a map of four neighborhood revitalization areas, and there's much more that can be done than workforce development.
Mr. Mayor, so if I and it's absolutely vital to recognize that this is conceptual. We believe that there's a lot of potential partners involved in this, certainly including Washburn Tech and even maybe the U. There's many other nonprofits that could play a role in terms of providing some of these services. The organizational structure is not even close. I think the focus right now should be on the projected outcomes, and the outcome is to meet a very specific need. And as we look at workforce development and the needs for this community to allow people to achieve their goals and their dreams, even if they don't know that their goals, even if they don't know it's their goals and dreams yet, you know, to challenge people to dream bigger, to allow people to wander into something because it seems like it's interesting and fun, and then discover that dream and grow from there. I don't think that program exists, not in Topeka. I don't know that program exists anywhere in the country. This is an opportunity to do something, you know, that's very unique. In one regard, you're focused on the workforce development, and sometimes I view it as a combination of workshop and community center and cheerleading area where somebody just wanders in and wants to work with wood, and all of a sudden, over a period of time, they get into some structure and they're learning to become a woodworker, and they can either through a series of steps, they could either become an employee for an organization, or maybe they find out that they're really good at building rocking chairs, and we work with them from an entrepreneurial perspective. So there's that one aspect from workforce development, but there's also the investment in the existing facilities. There's a lot of facilities that need some tender loving care, and it's very difficult to justify the investment that an individual person would make, especially if it's a startup or a fledgling business. We could step in there, and even if the business wasn't successful, you still have the facility there, and you can continue to focus on it. And then the other aspects of job training and other things. The goal is to invest in Topeka and invest in Topekans for the long term benefit of this community. And this is a tool that not very many communities have. And our recommendation is that we consider it as how it could help us.
Very good, Councilman Harmon.
Thank you, Your Honor. Jim, I want to thank you and your staff for your work on your proposal and your recommendations. I endorse each of the recommendations that you're making. And like the others have commented, I'm really excited about the Urban Economic Development Fund. That's one of the more exciting ideas that I've heard 10 years sitting on the council. And I think we certainly need to have further discussions to explore that possibility. Mayor, am I correct? Isn't Jay Garner looking at this as one of the issues, minority workforce disadvantaged. I thought that was part of the scope of the RFP.
Well, one of our requests to him was to look at the extent to which we are using the economic development funds best for the community, and I think comments were made along this line. So that would be something we don't know what were going to be recommendations, but
right.
Along that line, yes.
Okay, very good.
It's in our resolution.
Yeah, and Councilman De Lisla.
Yes, thank you, Mayor Wolgas. Deputy Mayor, just to echo a little bit on the comments that you made, I think that it's very important for us to remember that as a JADO body, we are the ones tasked to ensure that the direction that the contractor that we utilize is doing what they're supposed to do with regards to those areas. that being said, the focus point, when you look at the reports that are being provided at the JADO board meetings, have been on training on robotics in Highland Park. They have been on having a few breakfast training sessions, and there's been some talk about trying to help small business development as it is. But I think that I don't want for us to just close our eyes, because I mean, when you look at the $500,000 that are being allocated, I think that for the past 10 years, they haven't been completely expended. So this is something that we could be looking at as a body, and I think that as the JADO body, we should be analyzing the expenditure of those funds, the use of those funds, and then furthermore, expanding upon, because I see this more as a comeback of the First Step Fast Track type of classes, going back into those neighborhoods. There's so many wonderful possibilities that could come from this, but it's really important for us to know that, number one, we have Garner doing a study with regards to what those deficiencies are that I think would be wonderful for us to say, hey, we have this idea, let's bounce it by you as you're looking at the community as a whole. And of course, it allows us to provide some vision and direction as well to our contractor, now that we have the idea of this program, on how the rest of those funds would be allocated.
Thank you. Councilman Schwartz.
Thank you, Your Honor. I've been taking a little bit of heat from constituents out in Southwest Topeka because I am really a supporter of downtown and with what we had last week and the week before and discussions with this. I think urban development is really good, but I also, when I hear that we're gonna concentrate on four neighborhoods with urban development, I think we probably have need all across the city for developing a workforce and keeping people employed. I cut out the section when Sasha came up and said that we get $18 million in grants and programs for, I don't remember exactly what it was called, but now you're gonna add another $15 million in these programs, whether it's SWORD or whatever. I don't wanna take any more heat and I do believe that what's good for Topeka is good for us all as a whole. I mean, I wanna represent my district, but I also feel like $15 million for urban development, we need to continue to discuss that and how that's gonna be spent. $45 million for making the expo whole or like new or whatever, I think that number was high, but you're reducing that down and then you're gonna spend $15 million on the urban economic development zone, which I believe is mostly inner city. Is that not correct? As far as the four neighborhoods that you want to spend the $15 million on.
Do you want to respond?
Mr. Mayor and Councilmember Schwartz. So we had provided a map just as this was actually provided by the planning director, which ties into the neighborhood revitalization area. So that was the idea was that was probably the best place to start the discussion as opposed to a specific boundary demarcation.
Councilman Cohen? I'm sorry.
You
finished? Okay. Councilman Cohen.
Thank you. As an entrepreneur, I like this. I like it a lot. I just would like to ask that we continue focusing on spending as much possible money that was allocated in that tax for the streets. Walking door to door, we heard streets every day. And we dragging the neighborhood saw the streets every day, and we'd really like to make sure that that is earmarked for sure. And then I'd also like to make sure that we have accountability of the money spent so that we don't run into issues like our current economic development contractor runs into. And if passed, I'd like to make sure we have a plan to track the metrics over the next couple of years to make sure that our money is being spent in the right areas and that we do get some result from those training programs or whatever it is. That's all I have.
Okay.
Thanks.
Good. Councilman DeLisa.
Councilwoman. I would just
thank you.
It's okay, I've been called Mr. and Councilman, so I should talk like this tonight.
All right, all right. You use your other voice.
I am. There was a statement that was made that was very accurate. What is great for the community is, what is great for the city trickles down to all of our districts and all of our neighborhoods. And as an individual that looks at everything from a economy perspective and from a business perspective, there's two different type of investments. There's the investments that you can have immediate cash deposit so that you can have an immediate outcome. And those investments typically are the fixed investments that will eventually depreciate. But then there's investments in people that when you raise the stock of the individuals living within a community and you make sure that you make that investment on bettering the quality of life through employment, you start seeing a ripple effect that will start generating in the end, long-term, more funds for the city as a whole. And though I respectfully understand that there's constituencies, I mean, we've all heard the concerns with regards to money going one way in the city or the other, but I think that it is very important to us as a city to take a really big step in understanding that if we've been looking at the last few reports that have been provided to us by nationwide consultants, and even when Mr. Feyander gave us our report, that stated what happened with the condition of our city and our neighborhoods going up and down in a decline in the last 4 years that we have. Although I will say that overall the picture was positive, but in the last few years we've had an echo of individuals losing jobs. The number one thing that has affected us is poverty. And I think that it's paramount that as a city we take a position that in turn would transform into additional funds, because when you raise the stock of an individual that is able to work, when you work with individuals in an area that is impoverished and you're able to move them from a position of need to a position of success, the whole city benefits. So whereas I absolutely agree that we do have projects that merit our roads being taken care of, absolutely. I just have to state yet again that it's really important for us to do something to invest in our people so that eventually our residents are able to contribute more, our neighborhoods become better, and more dollars are being spent in the grocery stores and in the places that are eventually going to feed our city. So although I fully respect and understand the point of view of how focusing on impoverished individuals and trying to give them training versus roads, I will go with the individuals of my neighborhoods any day.
Okay, thank you. We have a person signed up. We'll come back. We'll take a little break from our discussion for a minute and have public comment on this item. But first, Joe Ledbetter.
Governing body, I'm in agreement with most of this proposal. I find it very interesting, especially paragraph 6, the Urban Economic Development Fund, including veterans. There's 16,000 of them in Shawnee County, and although not all of those are working age anymore, there's probably at least 8,000 to 10,000 of them that are, and could probably, some of them, use some help. I want to know what the word facilities means. Is that commercial facilities?
Where is that?
It's in, I'm still in paragraph 16 under the Urban Economic Development Fund. I'm not sure what that word is defined as. I understand infrastructure. And then, I don't know, does that include housing or not?
Underutilized.
One of the things that I'll just keep talking while you have a discussion. The area of High Crest is one of these that is in the maps, the High Crest West. Let's be very specific about that. I can look at all of High Crest, 6,000 residents in High Crest, and I've been helping them for a number of years. And I can tell you that I can't find $1 of the economic development funds that has been spent in the boundaries of High Crest over those years. 14 years of a sales tax with economic development and that large of a population not being served has to be repeated across the city. I think that there's large parts of this city that have never seen a dime of those funds that were allocated to go to PICA, the contract for JADA. So I'm very interested in this concept. And I'm very interested in areas east of the tracks and maybe north there in some of those blighted areas actually receiving some actual help from the sales taxes that they all pay. I don't see them being exempted from those sales taxes like Gotapeka, but I do see them paying them. Even kids pay it. I have a problem with a couple words being added in this, and I think it was dealt with in a comment earlier, but on page 3, under economic development, you've got JADO, you've got Gotapeka for 15 years. I absolutely vehemently disagree with that. They are not part of the sales tax. It was not in the ballot that it said Gotapeka. In fact, it didn't say JADO. JADO has the option of hiring its own staff and doing its own economic development. If they would just oversee the funds, as I've been urging them to do, and do their own oversight and their fiduciary responsibilities. I have too many problems with Gotapeka to list tonight, as do many other people in this community, but I do not appreciate their name being put on this for $75 million. That's a mistake, and I think they're listed on, well, I'll call it page 5. Again, they're singled out as a contractor, and they're not even part of the ballot, and they only go 1 year if the 3-year contract is even followed into that tax. And as we all know, their contract can be ended in 180 days on notice. So I don't see why their name is even in this document. And I disagree that they, I mean, I strongly disagree that they've done a good job with those funds, and especially with the disadvantaged funds, which they have not spent yearly, annually, the whole amounts. And I've looked back at those documents. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. City Manager, would you want to just comment on underutilized facilities? You see that on page 2 under item 6, where you talk about the economic development, and primarily funds could be directed toward these particular areas.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, to address that. The sentence reads underutilized facilities and infrastructure to attract economic development prospects. So we would the contemplation there would it would be commercial, industrial, office-oriented facilities. Who knows? It could be the conversion of a large house to a building too. So at this point, the expectation that wouldn't be for residential housing.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Other comments there before we go back on the comments that were made. Okay. I think we're going back to other discussion then. Deputy Mayor Hiller.
The question I had was regarding the pedestrian plan that's been suggested by city staff. I am very much in favor, of course, of doing the pedestrian plan, but it was not on the ballot. So I wondered how it was that staff felt we would be able to spend these dollars on the pedestrian plan.
So I think I got, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, I think I got corrected on that and didn't change it. I think I think the plan was to make that as part of the bikeways master plan, but if you don't mind, I'd like to research that and come back to you. But
okay.
I think I made an error there.
Thank you.
And I think my staff had actually told me I made an error and I didn't.
Well, it's pretty darn good, so if you missed a couple things. Right. Thank you.
Councilman Jensen.
So a couple of quick comments. Correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is with the JADO contractor, to some degree, some of the minority funding there, it's somewhat reactionary in that minority folks have to approach the contractor in order to access some of those funds. Part of the reason why I'm so excited about this economic development program, or the urban economic development program, is that it's much less reactionary. We're going out into those communities and we're working with those people, we're building the facilities, we're trying to get things ready for them there. So rather than wait for one of them to have an idea, come and try to get some assistance, we're going out there and we're putting the facilities and we're putting the ability for them to get off the ground right there in front of them and really giving them access without having to drive downtown. So I just wanted to make, again, correct me if I'm wrong, I wanted to make that distinction and the difference between how we're currently funding minority economic development and how I perceive that this additional $15 million would fund minority economic development and why it's so critical to have that second avenue into those communities. Thank you.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor Hiller.
Well, just for conversation purposes, to Councilwoman Schwartz's point, I really appreciate that the city manager put this out for discussion and is expecting that we'll discuss it and think about it more. It's fresh for all of us. In terms of the map, which is a good suggestion, but that's all it is right now, the neighborhood revitalization area is pretty big. Another map for maybe all of us to keep in mind. I think everybody has seen it, but if you look at the map of where the tax credit housing is across the city of Topeka and even into the county, it is sprinkled all over the city. And folks that are in tax credit housing or other assisted housing units are generally of lower income or are working at lower waged jobs. And so that would be another thing for us to consider as we even we'll probably approve this interlocal agreement before we do the specifics on exactly how a workforce program would be approached. But, you know, that map would be helpful for us to target through as well.
Okay. Councilman Schwartz.
Thank you. And just as a follow-up, District 7 has the most public housing units in the city.
Yes.
So,
there you that's go.
That's true. That is true.
Tax credit housing.
All right.
Or public.
Yeah. All right. We are going. Council, our city manager, then will certainly don't meet for 2 weeks. Do see this time frame, and then in October, we'll come back with maybe another discussion and clarification for anything, and then we're ready to take another vote at some point. And I'm just, you know, just general thinking about what our procedure would be.
So, yes, Mr. Mayor and council members, I think I would like, within 2 weeks, we could come back with a specific resolution. If there's a desire for another week or so to generate some internal conversation within your districts, I think we're, from a staff perspective, we're okay with that. So, I'll plan on coming back in 2 weeks unless I hear a lot ahead, but 3 weeks. Okay, we'll come back in 3 weeks. Thank you.
Right. Okay.
Got it.
You'll be alone here in 2 weeks. There's no meeting in 2 weeks.
I'll be back in 3 weeks.
All right. Thank you.
You can send it out in 2 weeks.
Any other discussion? That completes Councilman Ortiz. Councilwoman Ortiz.
City Manager, would you send out that language to all of us so that we understand the ballot language?
Mr. Mayor and Councilman Ortiz, yes. We'll put together a packet. Without overwhelming you, we'll put together information
good.
That would be
good
the ballot
point.
Language and others.
All right.
Can I comment on one thing?
Sure.
I think it is imperative that I do get it, that we do get it out public
mm-hmm.
a week or so in advance so that you do have a chance. So
right.
there's some good conversation. So we will, as early as possible, get the language out.
Good. Councilman Shum.
Along those lines, I would like to see in 3 weeks when we meet again just another discussion only item for more input on
mm-hmm.
your proposal
yeah.
and not have it as an action item until the following week at the earliest.
Yeah,
that would be
my
request.
I think that's consensus. Okay,
sure.
Moving on. We're ready for item B. The clerk to read.
is a discussion relating to a new East Topeka interchange.
And Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I am going to quickly hand this over to Mr. Gerber. I know that he's worked very closely with several members of staff pertaining to how we came to this. From a historical perspective, this was discussed in several different locations for a long time. It actually was included in the city's priorities to the KTA and to KDOT. I believe that was through Mr. Whitaker's group. But at this point, what we want is the same thing. This actually requests for us to participate in a funding of the research project. Actually got to us either Friday or I think it was Friday, well, not too long ago. We put it on the agenda because we just wanted to see if this body was interested. If they are, we want to participate in the research project and then come back with more specific information, or if not, to proceed.
Okay, Mr. Gerber.
Governing body, thank you. As the city manager stated, this is an item that's been talked about off and on for a number of years. Certainly we, in doing some research for this, we found a study that was done in 2006 by KTA in conjunction with the city that didn't appear to have much legs to it, but we're back at it and have been having this discussion again with the Turnpike Authority, and it appears, at least from the KTA's perspective, that they have more interest in this at this point, and we're here in front of you to see if the interest is mutual. So begin with the end in mind. What we'd like to do tonight is have this discussion and then hopefully bring it to you for some type of potential decision on one option to consider at your next meeting, which we've accurately pointed out is 3 weeks from now, not 2 weeks. So our intent would be to bring this back at the October 6th meeting for a potential decision. We do have a brief presentation for you, which we'll go through. But before we get into that, again, this has been ongoing for a number of years. They've looked at a number of locations. This time as well, KTA has done what they call some cartoon engineering. So it's very, very rough sketches, just nothing very official, but it gives everybody kind of an idea of where the impacts might be and where things might be located. Concentrating specifically at a California interchange, KTA interchange, or a 29th Street one. So there's two options that were presented for each of those. And this is really based on a change in philosophy at KTA, which is that they're relying less on their economics, although that's certainly important, but they're also relying on partnering or preferring to partner with local communities and provide economic development impacts towards those communities rather than just simply driving new ridership on the turnpike or making sure that it works from a cost analysis from their perspective. So with that background, I'd like to go ahead and get into our presentation. Everybody I think is aware, but you can see on the map visually where the interchanges might be located. Currently we have, of course, an interchange at Topeka Boulevard, and then again one on the clear east side of town. That leaves a gap of 6 miles between access, which is interesting because if you look at the rest of the city, the average access citywide is about a mile. If you look at the I-70 exit ramps and the 470 exit ramps, it's about a mile. And so there's I think clearly a need there and a gap there in our service area, or in their service area. The city manager referenced that we work closely with a number of other city departments, including Mr. Feiner in the planning department and Mr. Whitaker in public works. One of the things the planning department did in preparation for this was pull the parcels in the area that is specifically impacted by this, and it amounts to about 32,000 residents, or about a quarter of our population have this essentially service gap. So again, back to the why. As discussed, we think there's some economic development and growth opportunities by engaging in this project. They're largely undefined right now, but
We think the potential is great for some growth in that whatever option is chosen by the council. This was a LUGMUP priority, tier one priority, investment priority, which as everybody remembers from their extensive study of this document, that's just sort of the growth that's internal to the city. It does connect the city, and there, you know, there's an element of environmental and there's an equity element and some environmental justice associated with this. Certainly, as discussed, we're denying, not denying access, but access is not what it could be for 25% of our residents, and we think we need to address that. This was one of two MTPO priorities at the local consult. KDOT has those meetings on a routine basis to hear from their communities as to what the community priorities are. This was one of Topeka's priorities, the other one being a study of Arvillion 470 and that exit there and how we can improve that. Additionally, it had it did wind up in the city's CIP in 2020. There's $500,000 potentially allocated. It's not in the CIP yet, so it's not in the budget portion, but in the CIP piece in 2020, there's $500,000 already set aside for design of this potential project. The most important part of what can happen with this is if we proceed with this project and if the council is supportive of it, then it allows us to be included in KTA's 10-year long-term needs plan, and that's pretty critical. As I indicated in the email I sent to you, if we're not in that 10-year needs plan, it's very unlikely that the project will happen. But if we are, obviously it's likely that the project will happen. And again, as noted when I first started talking, KTA is very supportive of this. They've already engaged some engineering to do these cartoon engineering drawings for us. It's a very technical term that they keep using, but we'll go through those here in a second. And so they've already put some upfront cost into this to show that they're serious about this and they're willing to partner with us to split the cost of a 10% design study. So at the end of this process, at the end of a 45 to 60 day process, we would have plans that give us 10% engineering completed. And that would be at a cost of about $20,000. So the four options that they looked at on our behalf were, the first is at Southeast 29th, and that's a traditional diamond interchange with the four boosts there. As I have previously indicated to you, there's some positives and negatives about each of these concepts. This certainly gives us a good quality of local access. The construction cost, which have not yet been determined, we really don't know what those are. But just a really first blush look at these, in terms of a ranking of 1 to 4, this would be the second cheapest option for the city to consider. So that's what the $2 signs are. Those don't correlate to anything more than that. That's the second lowest cost. Impact to land uses, in terms of impact to the neighborhoods, in terms of impact to city streets, this would be rated as a lower impact project. The one potential downside to this option is that if you look at the sort of farthest left toll booth there, the yellow block, that's where an existing fire station is, and so there would potentially have to be associated with this project a fire station relocation. So moving on to the second option, again, Southeast 29th option. It's an offset diamond with one toll booth or one payment place. Again, quality of local access is good. This would appear to be the least costly of the options. Has moderate impact to land uses. One of the potential concerns, just looking at this at first blush, is that where they have indicated that the interchange would be off of 29th Street is potentially too close to the California intersection. There's already, you know, some traffic issues in that area, and so putting it that close to the signal may back up
traffic and may have some unintended consequences that no one would be happy with. So that would be worth looking at as well. The third option they considered for us was the Southeast California Diamond coming off of California Street. Acceptable quality of local access. This would be the second most expensive project. It would have a significant impact, high impact to land uses because it's more of a residential area than Southeast 29th is more of a commercial area. We would absolutely have to extend California to five lanes through and south of the bridge. So it would have to, California would have to go to five lanes. Right now it's potentially slated to be five lanes up to that point and then three lanes south of that. So that would necessitate a change in city CIP plans. And most importantly, you would have to raise the bridge over California Street. It would not be high enough by, they estimate, a foot and a half. And so the bridge would have to be raised. You can't lower California Street because you get into stream quality impact issues. So obviously raising a bridge raises the cost of the project. And then the fourth option is a bit of a unique option. It's the folded diamond. Again, acceptable local access. It would be the most expensive one, and it would have a high impact on land use in the area to the residents in the area. Again, it would require the same thing as the previous California project, that would be the raising of the bridge and extending five lanes south on California. So in terms of the next steps that we anticipate, as discussed, we want to try to get this back a resolution of support from the council of the concept study on October 6th. Between now and then, we would anticipate having being able to arrange some neighborhood meetings, perhaps in consultation with Councilman Shum, to get some feedback from the folks in the area so we could understand what their input would be. So we would want to do that between now and the next meeting. As indicated, KTA would perform that study within 40, we say 60 days, they say 45 to 60, but under promise and over deliver. So hopefully it would be back sooner than 60 days. We would want to start looking at what the potential true impact would be to city streets. And then we would need to start having a discussion as to what our cost sharing model might be in terms of the overall project cost with the Turnpike Authority. I believe that is the last slide. So with that, I will sit for questions.
But just a question on the resolution, which we have a copy of in here. We are agreeing to participate in the study. Prior to the study being done, there really is, we can be providing information, but they're really doing an engineering study. Is that, or, you know, we get input from the neighborhoods, do they want to hear what we are hearing?
Mr. Mayor, governing body, that's correct. What the resolution of support would do would be to essentially tell us to move forward with partnering with them on this study. Of one option. I probably wasn't very clear about that. The cost, that $40,000 cost that we would be splitting with KTA provides for study of one option. And so at some point the council would need to come to consensus on what that one option that
by
would best serve the city.
By the time we agree to the resolution?
Indeed, yes.
Okay, so if you say this is coming back in 3 weeks, at that time we will vote on which option we prefer.
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
We certainly have some soft recommendations from a cost and access and impact perspective. Staff's preference is 29th Street, but that's without hearing from the impacted neighborhoods.
And if the study then came back, whatever the study is, that means they would do it where we make the decision. Our recommendation is option one, that's what they're going to do.
Mr. Mayor, it's our understanding that if we proceed with option X, whatever that is,
that's better.
Then yes, that would be the project that they would move forward with.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Councilman Shum.
Deputy City Manager, wanting to take a cue from the county, do we have the expected lifespan on that KTA bridge, how much use is left in it before it would need to be replaced?
I don't think we have the answer to that question.
Could we get that in the next few weeks?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Other questions? Councilman Jensen.
Thank you for your presentation. I have a couple of quick questions. And a comment right off the bat, it looks like Southeast 29th Street appears to be a better solution. I'm curious if, I'll try to ask this without opening a can of worms. In the resource allocation study as part of the fire department, we had discussed the possibility of moving a couple of fire stations. I'm wondering if the fire station on 29th was part of that. Does anyone know?
No, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think so. I don't believe so.
Okay, not a big deal. On the 229th Street options, are either of those, are there housing involved in any of that would need to be taken? Or is it all, or do we know it may be too premature for that?
Mr. Mayor, Council Member, it is a bit premature, but okay. Based on their conceptual drawings, there would be some impacted housing.
Okay.
Yes.
And then my last question, part of the idea behind the turnpike is that only the folks that are using it pay for it. So I'm curious, is there a possibility of, you know, raising the toll at this particular exit 10 cents or what have you to cover the cost of building that, or is that even an option or a good idea?
That would be, Council Member, I think that would best be a decision left to KTA.
Okay.
I'm sure we could provide input, but that's something I'm sure they'd want to discuss with their board.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Shum.
Certainly, I'd like to speak to a few things that were brought up there. One, I'm not in support of the fire department being moved, the fire station being moved. Station 9 is heavily utilized, especially compared to some other stations, and so I could not, in good conscience, support it being moved from our area. Two, as far as raising tolls go, the toll starts at the Topeka interchange, and then goes to wherever you get off if you're heading east. So adding an extra fee into that would be counterintuitive. They cannot raise the price more than it would cost you to get off at Topeka, or defeat the whole purpose because people would just drive the extra few 6 miles to get off at the Topeka interchange. So I'm not sure that would work from the KTA's perspective. With that being said, at initial blush, I'd be most likely to support the second option because of the impact of the residential areas would be less. And, but I do want to make sure that not lost in this discussion is the fact that we have to get California done and done on time as it's scheduled for next year.
One point you, I think you intimated that the city, it'd be appropriate, the city will bear some cost for the construction of this interchange, or is that?
That's correct, Mr. Mayor.
So actually the total cost of whatever the project is reflects also back on the city. Our share will vary with whichever option is taken. It could.
Correct. I would reemphasize that we don't. This is all very preliminary and we don't have cost. Looking back through the documents from 2006 when this was examined, they estimated the cost would be about $7 million. It's my understanding now, though, that when they program these new interchanges in, they're looking at a cost that's approximately double that.
Mm-hmm. And any idea what our percent, our share, our opportunity to participate, at what level?
The only conversation we've had with them, Mr. Mayor, at this point is that as we ratchet up our cost share participation, it would ratchet up the proposal on the priority list.
A moving percentage, perhaps, Mr. City Manager.
So I think sometimes it's important to say things. I said, Doug made reference to a soft recommendation on the part of the city that is the option two that's up there. We believe that from a cost perspective, from an impact on city operations, understanding that we'd have to have some conversations pertaining to the ingress and egress point as mm-hmm. it interacts with 29th. We would need to address that, but I don't want this to become a conversation about fire departments and everything else. If we were to recommend going forward, which we would do it very softly at this point, given where we're at in the conversation, it would be this one based on the potential impact of the city.
All right. Mm-hmm. Councilman Ortiz.
Thank you. I too like number two, looking at that. And I know that this has been on the table for as long as I've been on this table, for a long time. It's been taken off, put on. And I think a lot of the residents want it. I think it will boost economic development. I think it would be able to bring some of those trucks through there. So I kind of like number two. And you know, with all due respect, Jim, I don't want to relocate a fire station if we don't have to.
I said the same thing.
Okay. Yeah. I just want to make it clear. I just don't want to do that. We can't even get 13 up and running. So I just don't want to do that. I want to keep it as simple as possible. And I think the other plans that we looked at, that was the $7 million, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Gerber, that was on California. And I think that they talked about lifting the bridge. They talked about acquiring all that land and stuff like that, and how they had these big loops and stuff like that. That was the last I remember on that. And I think that might have been a big reason why those numbers were up. Not to say that it's not expensive, I'm just saying that was my last recollection of it.
Councilwoman, that's correct. In looking back through those 2006 documents, it was a location off of California Street.
Okay. Deputy Mayor Hilbert.
Thank you, Mayor. My thought is that I'm of this council. I came on after 2006, and so aside from knowing that conceptually some people thought this was a good idea and have advocated for it, I've never been involved in a discussion about exactly where and how it should function, besides a couple phone calls that I've gotten in the last couple of days. And since I recently, maybe the only person that's gone through that, but the Polk Quincy Viaduct relocation is in my district. And just to come up with concept and location, we spent months of engaging the businesses as well as the residents, not just the organized neighborhood associations, but affirmative publicity to get the residents out. And we learned so much from people who ask questions about, you know, well, where would this intersection be and what will that do to how I get to work and how I get home and do I like it or not and so on. And so I certainly, if we've got KTA's attention, would not want to discourage that by delaying inordinately, and I don't know what the routine is, but I also personally would not be comfortable advocating for any of these options until I knew that it had been well vetted by the people who live there, both in terms of why they want it. Because when you put these intersections in, you tie up a lot of land. We did the K4 extension in East Topeka with the idea that it was going to bring all this economic development to East Topeka, and what it did was provided a quick way for people not to go through town and get out to Lake Perry. And I'm not saying that's bad or good, but it didn't bring economic development, and I wouldn't want to locate an intersection with, I'd want to know why we were doing it and be sure we weren't getting in the way of doing it. This particular option too doesn't take as much land right next to 29th Street or California, which helps in terms of not being as disruptive as perhaps some of the other ideas. But I would sure want to hear, I did hear a little bit from people who didn't want it on California because they didn't want it to slow down the project that's up. And they also were talking about how people come in on K-10, they take 45th Street to avoid paying the toll and go up California to get to work or downtown or wherever their jobs are. And that individual thought they'd probably keep doing that, people that don't want to pay the toll. Well, that's okay, but it's good to know that California is used in that way now. If 29th Street between the lake and California is the best place for it, I would still want to hear from those businesses and really work hard on the neighborhoods and the people that have wanted it to let them poke at it and give us feedback. And with that then, if that can all be done in 2 weeks, okay, but I would think it might take a little more time. We actually organized we'd had a whole round of hearings on Polk Quincy and kind of had something tentative and realized that the way it was structured, because it's hard to look at these maps and know what's going over and what's going under and where there's a stoplight, it's kind of hard to figure out what's really going to happen. was that people, in the case of mine, didn't realize it was going to knock out the intersection at First in Topeka that everybody uses a lot. And so we ended up getting a multi-neighborhood meeting together of the four contiguous neighborhoods on that First Street corridor, which was very beneficial. We had two meetings. We had 60 people at the first one and 30 at the second one because they really cared about it. So just want to, besides my personal vote, I would want to encourage us to make sure we've engaged folks. Thank you.
Councilman Jensen.
So in looking at option two, I see a significant bottleneck there. And you know, if you compare that to option one, where you have four access points to one access point, and then the fact that it's a 90 degree hanging off of 29th Street, are we absolutely certain that a single access point is going to be enough to facilitate rush hour traffic and not back up into California? This just looks like it's going to be a line to get on and off this thing if it's as popular as folks have advocated it is. I just have big concerns with the way that's laid out.
Okay.
Any comments on that?
Mr. Gerber, you want to respond?
A couple of comments. If I may go back to Deputy Mayor Hiller's comments.
Just so you don't forget this one.
I promise.
Okay.
We are backing up against a KTA deadline for them to finalize their long-term needs plan, which is in November. And so we need to, that's why we'll want to have these local impact meetings here within the next couple of weeks and try to really get project feedback in that time frame. In terms of Councilman Jensen's question, that's something that I think will come once we understand, once the council selection option and we get into more of that design phase. I'm not sure we're going to know that prior to that.
Well, my concern though is, if we only have one option we can do a study on, and we pick the wrong one, then we've wasted a study because it'll come back and say there's too much of a bottleneck here to be successful. So I feel like in order for us to select an option to do the study on, given our time frame, we have to know going in that option is not going to have problems down the road other than it would just be bad design. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not an engineer, but.
Additionally, I would suggest, Mr. Mayor and Councilman Jensen, that this is a proposal that KTA brought to us.
Mm-hmm.
And so internally, they vetted the idea that this one access point will be able to serve their needs as well as the needs of Topeka.
Okay. I'd be interested to see their information that backs that up because I can't fathom that one access point is sufficient for a freeway, but yeah, I could be wrong on that.
Councilwoman Clare.
Okay, let me see if I understand. If we do the study, they put it into their long-term needs plan and they might do it? What's a long-term need? Is that what you're saying?
Mr. Mayor, Councilwoman Clare, their long-term needs plan is analogous to our CIP. It's just simply their planning document. And so if we do this study, it solidifies the fact that this plan will move forward some point within the next 10 years.
Funding of the availability of funding and all the other considerations. Councilman Shum.
Certainly, a couple of things that I keep in mind because it is my district. One, we are working on getting California to at least three lanes and five lanes possibly from 29th south to the bridge area. So whichever way we go on this. So that would start to help address the bottleneck issue as far as people getting onto California. It's certainly something to keep in mind, though. The other thing I would say is that right now KTA is offering to split the cost of the study with us. So if we take this study and it's completely infeasible, we've paid half as much as we normally would for that study. And so I'm looking forward to public input over the next few weeks because I'm pretty sure of all the people in the council, I'm going to get the most phone calls on this issue. I certainly hope so, and the most emails. And I look forward to that. And part of the reason I put my opinion out there is I want people to know where I'm coming from so they can start arguing with me. Tell me why I'm wrong or why I'm right, and I can adjust my ideas accordingly. Other than getting rid of the fire station, that's the only thing right now I'm drawing a line in the sand on, is I don't want to relocate the fire station. I don't want that to be up for debate. I am looking forward to the input, but again, it is a half-price study, and so I do think we should take advantage of the opportunity before it becomes $40,000 of city money that we're committing to do a study on it. proposed location.
Okay, if this is a point, let's go to a public comment of a person to speak. Joe Ledbetter.
Governing body, I may actually ask for some more time. I'll see. First off, any of these four options is better than the nothing that's been there for 50 years. This area is sorely underserviced. Lawrence, which used to be much smaller than Topeka, has three exits. We've got two at best. Really, the east exit is not really much of an exit. It's kind of a mishmash. And one of the reasons that maybe K4 didn't align as well as people thought is because, you know, you can't even get an exit off of Croco on I-70. So they poorly designed that interchange. And it's from a lack of access points and entrances. And that is the problem with East Topeka development. There is not access for 6 miles onto a ribbon of commercial trade that could be coming into this area of 29th and California. Now, Highcrest NIA actually passed a resolution over 2 years ago stating support for an entrance on the Kansas Turnpike. At that time, they said on California. That's in our minutes, I can get that. I talked to the manager about this in 2013. We had a meeting up here and said, we need to get something going on this turnpike. I talked to a very large developer today, Tom Peterson. I'm going to give this out. Now, he does not talk about specifically the Kansas Turnpike in this, but he talks about the widening of California and how necessary it is. And I'm going to put this into the record and pass that around, please. And he does talk about the need for 5 lanes on California. And in looking at these options, I want to go over them. Option two, people are talking about because it's the least cost. As I said, any of these options is better than nothing, which is what we have. But option two puts this entrance awfully close to that intersection. And I'm wondering about crossing traffic as you're going into the commercial area. You're going to have to cross traffic on 29th to get over to that north lane, which will take you west. And you won't have to cross it coming back. But it does appear on face to be a bit of a bottleneck. Option one, if you look at option four, I don't know why you couldn't do a folded diamond on the north side where, and then take away that one entrance, which would cut through the fire station, and then fold it back. That area is much more flat than the area on the east side of the turnpike, which is fairly steep, especially that north side of 29th. So you have a lot less topography problems to work with if you did that. So you could eliminate that entry exit, or that it's an entry on that south side if they could reconfigure that. Let me talk about California and the letter I just handed out, and I'm gonna ask for more time. The bridge is over 50 years old, the KTA bridge. They've been replacing them historically about every 50 years. All of these bridges in Shawnee County were built I believe in the mid to late 50s, so it is over 50 years old. They did raise the bridge on Wittenberg Road slightly, which they just did last year. I'm going to request 2 more minutes.
Okay. Councilwoman De Alisa moves to extend by 2 minutes. Councilman Shum seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor vote yes. Opposed vote no. I vote yes.
10 yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Continue.
10. On California, the option four has the double backs. I understand that there's costs associated with a bridge. We're not talking about doing this tomorrow. But that bridge is dated. It's going to have to be replaced. I don't see it as something they're going to keep off their construction table for that long. It should always, it should be wider by any stretch of the imagination. California should have been made a five-lane road a long time ago versus probably taking Croco from 29th to 45th, which didn't serve that many people. However, even then when they did that, it did help development at 29th and Croco. There's no question about it. And there's a lot of newer buildings in that area that Tom Peterson built, other developers built. And, you know, one of the things that he told me, he'd like this council to just hear out. And I said, that's strange, because I said that same word to the manager last year, late last year. It's urgency. We have got to, as a body, whether it's JADO or the county or the city that I'm now addressing, we have got to start having a lot more urgency about economic development and about solving long-term problems. And I would say, especially on the east side, that's been sorely neglected. You can see that with the KTA access points versus 470, which has a lot of access points. And, you know, it's boomed along the 470 corridor for a number of years. And all I'm asking is that East Topeka be given a chance to also share in that economic development. And, you know, I have been told that one of the stores, the 29th in California, is going to be closing in the next month. I'm just going to leave that out right now, but we've got to get some development over there. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Councilman Councilman Jensen.
We are both dressed in snappy suits, so it's an understandable mistake. Hey. Given all the discussion about moving a fire station, first of all, I would never advocate that the fire station be moved completely out of the district. You know, if we had to build a new one and slide it up or down the street a little bit, then that would be the question. I'm wondering, is there an option 1A that could be developed without moving a fire station that would still give us four access points to the interstate as opposed to one? And I don't know if that's something we can ask the KTA about or what, but if there's a hybrid answer to one and two, I would think that would be probably the most ideal, just my thought. Be interested to see what the KTA says about that. Thank you.
I have one little minor point. This is called the East Topeka Interchange, and I know areas of the city mean many different things to different people. To me, this is very southeast Topeka. I would say almost the East Topeka Interchange, I think, is the one at I-70 on the east side of town. But so I don't know, maybe this is the name that KTA started using, but I think it's something that we might want to look at. And Highland Park, High Crest, the Jonathan Shum Interchange, however you want to go. I just think we could be more creative.
I prefer Wolgast. That has a better ring to it.
But I think we want to be sure, because this will go, if this goes forever, we want to make sure that it's appropriate to the area of the city and the Elmer City. Any other comments on discussion item D? Seeing none, we will proceed to item 7, announcements. There is no council meeting next week, so there is no preliminary agenda. Mr. City Manager, for your announcements.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to congratulate Councilmember Shaw that his Modern Work Woodman Fraternal Financial was voted the best financial advisor retirement planning company in Topeka. So that's very good. Congratulations to you and to your company for that. That's really great. Habitat for Humanity, Councilmember De La Isla's organization was also chosen as the best builder remodeler for residential. So we've got some pretty pretty stellar people sitting up here today. So congratulations to both of you. I also want to recognize that next time we meet, Mary Feeney will happily be sitting in the audience.
At home.
Or she'll be home. Watching on TV, sending me notes. Lisa Robertson starts on September 28th, and we'll be sitting in this chair and We look forward to her, but I really want to thank Mary for the excellent counsel that she has provided to us, this organization, and certainly to me personally. So thank you, Mary.
You're welcome.
It's been fun, but it's not ending either, because I'm still down the hall.
Yes.
So, and then on Thursday, the Water Festival at Garfield Park. That will be a great opportunity to hang out with a bunch of fourth graders.
Thank you. Councilman De La Isla.
A few comments. First of all, just want to reiterate our support for Topeka Police Department. Very satisfied that we're finally in agreement. It was wonderful to hear from the leader of that group when we were being told that an impasse had been ended, and the chief's words said, I really care not only about our organization as a city, but I really want to ensure that our staff feel supported. And it's, we've reached this disagreement, and I feel strongly about us going ahead and moving forward because we all want to be working together. And that's the spirit of leadership that moves us forward. It was a lot of work, but it got done. So to the HR staff, Jackie, to our legal staff that was working in this, and to everybody overall, thank you. And to our men and women in blue, thank you for your patience and for your service to our community. A fun tidbit that I just found out today after consuming food over at Julie's, there were only like 100 or 100 and something restaurants chosen by chefs throughout the nation. And Julie from downtown was selected as one of the places to come up with one special breakfast dish. And if you guys want to try it out, it is an awesome bagel sandwich with sausage and eggs. It's got barbecue sauce and maple cream cheese. And if you like it, you go and you vote for it, and downtown Topeka and Julie's restaurant could be recognized for being the winner of that challenge, and it could help, you know, the organization. So I just thought that that was a really cool thing, that our friend Julie was selected for that, so just giving her a prop for that. And finally, on a very selfish but really happy thing that happens in our our elementary schools, Randolph Elementary, as elementary schools go, they don't have a student council body. But what they do in Randolph Elementary, which I think is really cool, is that they have this group called the Dream Team. And kids have to interview in order for them to be able to participate and demonstrate values that allow them to get selected. And then these kids themselves put together plays to the rest of the student body that exemplify positive behaviors and that address negative behaviors in the school. And that's a really neat thing. And the reason that I'm saying that it's very selfish is because I want to give a shout out to little Miss Lorraine De La Isla, who was elected by all of her student body members president after having me bake 48 cupcakes. But she was selected president. Another name that is very well known is Miss Maggie Manspeaker is selected the vice president of this group. So to those two young ladies and to all of the kids over at Randolph, I want to tell you all, I am so proud of the Randolph School. So when people talk so much about how negative 501 is, that is just one awesome program that allows the kids to shine. So thank you to our principal over there, and thank you to the school for having this program.
Thank you, Councilman Jensen.
Now that I have delicious sounding bagel on the brain, I forgot most of what I was going to comment on. Real quick, I also cannot remember when we had so many noise exceptions. And I just think that is fantastic for a community where we hear so much about there's nothing to do. We're going to beat it into you with sound, folks. This is fabulous. So if you can't find something to do, go to speak365.com. There's tons of things in our community. We're ramping up to the holiday season, and it's just going to be a wonderful time. So please get out and do something fun. These events that were mentioned here tonight are just some more great examples of how Topeka really is becoming an entertainment capital, and there's really always something to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Schwartz.
He stole my thunder on Best of Topeka, but I wanted to add the best family entertainment was the Topeka Zoo, and also a plug for my granddaughters who work at the best place to fill your sweet tooth, which is Orange Leaf. There were a couple in here that were not in Topeka, and it says Best of Topeka. So I hope someday that we get the best event in Northeast Kansas, and we also get the best casino and best live entertainment. So those are maybe future. The gem for Topeka this week for me is the League of Women Voters. We went Saturday night to Noto Arts Center to a poetry reading, and it was sponsored by the League of Women Voters, and the place was packed. I mean, it really was packed, and their theme was activism through the arts. And I think it's very, very much we need to encourage activism, especially in voting. And so they're my gem. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that the Zubilee is coming up on September 26th. So get your tickets and go to the zoo. Thanks.
Councilman Cohen, Councilman Harmon, Deputy Mayor Hiller.
Well, I need to chime in with events between now and the 1st of October as well. Also on the 26th of September, but during the day, you can do both of these. You can go to Zubilee in the evening, but the 10th annual Aaron Douglas Art Fair is Saturday the 26th from 10 to 5 at the Aaron Douglas Art Park at the corner of 12th and Lane. And that is a fair for diverse and emerging artists and to celebrate community. And one of the things that they will be actually doing an advanced celebration at the end of this week for people that have been involved in the development of the mural and of the fair. The mural was totally fundraised privately and installed in 2004-2005, and the fair, which also is funded privately, is in its 10th year, and you're going to look back at thank yous and what a difference that mural and those art fairs have made in kicking off the arts movement here. So it'll be a fun time.
Thank you. Councilwoman Claire.
September 19th at North Topeka Baptist at Gordon and Jackson, they're having a picnic, bounce houses, prizes, games from 4 to 5:30, and then you can go right over to the Kansas Avenue Methodist Church, and from 4 to 6:30, and they're having a meal and an old-fashioned hoedown. And I want you to think of me on the 26th. I'm going with my daughter in the Sheepdog Impact Assistant membership to New York, and I'm going to walk from the tower to the tunnels. And that's 3 miles, and I've been practicing, and I'm up to about 50 steps, so you know, I really need you to be with me here while I try and, she's going to full gear, me not so much.
Okay, good. Councilwoman Ortiz.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to say thank you to Richard for walking for our friend, or running for our friend in the cancer races this weekend. That was awesome what you did. Also, I'd like to say the Rock the Block at Highland Park was awesome, well attended, and I don't see Monique here, but Sasha's here, and it was awesome, and I look forward to many, many more to start a very good partnership with our young people on having them pick up trash. Or I know last night I attended Central Highland Park, and as well as Jonathan did, and we talked about maybe doing some snow shoveling and just giving them a sense of pride and some jobs and opportunities in this city to make them a part of this city. And I think that's what we're missing sometimes, is that we don't give them that sense of pride, and once they have it, they'll be more prideful. So It was very well attended. I had 3 meetings that day, but I did get over there, and it was awesome, and I look forward to more. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councilman Shum.
All right, well, I have to agree and disagree with Councilwoman Elaine Schwartz for a moment here. I'm disappointed in the Capital Journal. I know with 3 showings a month, we didn't even crack the top 10 for best live entertainment in Topeka.
You're talking about the council.
Yes, I'm talking about the council.
We got to get more voters.
I know. But they're, in all seriousness, these are really exciting times in Southeast Topeka. And I need to tip my hat to John Nave, Jack Wolfel, Denise Everhart, who put in countless hours to bring about some of these projects that we're looking at being a reality in the next 3 to 4 years, next 10 years for the KTA. I'm here standing on their shoulders, and for all of East Topeka and Southeast Topeka, we're grateful for their work, and we're ready to move forward and get these things done. So I appreciate the support and input from everyone on the council to move it along for a better Southeast Topeka. Thank you very much.
I want to add two other events going on within this time period. Actually, the first is tomorrow. Kansas is having its first mariachi festival. And tomorrow, the 16th, is Mexico's Independence Day, not in Cinco de Mayo when most Americans think it is. But this is a very important ethnic festival for the Hispanic community, and Topeka is blessed by having a significant Hispanic community, and we are richer for it. It kicks off tomorrow night out here at the statue of the mariachi group that lost their lives, and then we'll come into the TPAC, and it will continue on Thursday with events here in TPAC that evening. A very significant group coming in from San Antonio's entertainment. The other event is, this is a 60th anniversary year for the Rosa Parks ride for Freedom on the bus. And there are going to be many experiences with that. It kicks off in Topeka this Friday. Will be a Unity Walk press conference at the Brown v. Board building, at which the program will be described. The main event will be on Friday evening, October 2, when there will be a walk across the Kansas Avenue Bridge from Great Overland Station up over the flyover, then down into Noto, where there'll be a significant entertainment that evening by all different types of groups from the community. So this will be a tremendous organization among many different entities, organizations coming together to make this a significant event. So you'll be hearing a lot more about it, but it really kicks off. Going to be telling more about it this Friday at a press conference. And that completes the announcements. So we will go to public comment. Mr. Ledbetter.
Governing body, I believe we are great entertainment. Julie's is a great little restaurant, whatever. It's I've been there 3 or 4 times. You ought to try it. Don't forget Betty Dunn. She even got a park named after her. And she actually proposed and pushed for this form of government to be a manager form of government, along with some of us a number of years ago. I want to talk about the JADO meeting that happened last Wednesday night on the 9th. And I want to talk about what was missing. And what was missing was explanations on the PowerPoints as to what the little triangles and squares and zeros were. There was no factual information given out throughout the whole presentation that I could decipher. We didn't know how many jobs were supposedly being brought in. We didn't know what they were spending our money on. We know factually that they're using up about $2.5 million a year for what appears to be overhead. A lot of that money is being transferred to the Chamber of Commerce. I can find no records that gives them that authority. And we also found out at that meeting, and it's very interesting to me, first off, we already knew that Doug Kinzger never had a contract with GoTopeka. His contract was with the Chamber of Commerce. We now know that all the payroll is being done through the Chamber of Commerce and not GoTopeka. So the GoTopeka people are actually really Chamber employees. I know you may think they're not, but that's where they get their paychecks from. Of course, those paychecks would not be possible if it weren't for the good work, hard work of our taxpayers who pay that sales tax and make it possible. Because 20 employees down there could not exist without our subsidy. Also missing from the meeting on agenda item 9 was a discussion about economic development. And so who was not invited to the discussion? The public. The public at no point was invited to come up and ask or give their input as to how the economic development of this city and the contractor should be moving. So no matter how many consultants we hire, we still haven't got the message that the people need to be involved because we pay the bills and we're the citizens. And so what you're doing is you're cutting off a tremendous amount of creativity. You're cutting off a tremendous amount of people that may be smarter than the ones you've actually hired, actually who would possibly give you good dynamic ideas, but the public is not invited ever to speak at those discussion items. Now, tonight we had a discussion. We had several discussions. And the public, if they wanted to, could have come down here and spoken on any of those items. So the public was invited at this meeting. But JADO refuses to invite the public to those meetings. Well, we give you time at public comment. Well, if I hadn't pushed for that, you wouldn't even have that. That's the honest to God truth. But the truth is, that's at the end of the meeting. The items have already been discussed. So once again, we're just the caboose on the train. And we're being told, just follow us, follow the leader, whether it's over a chasm, over a canyon, bridges out, it doesn't matter, just follow, be quiet, sit at the back of the room or the back of the bus, and just sit where you're told, and don't discuss, and don't have a role in participation. So I just want to sum that up in case you missed it. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. There being no other business before the body, we are adjourned.